The conditions are getting critical. There is one image there that shows black people getting off.
So people with dark skin getting off?
Not dark, black.
Black skin?
Really black, black.
Dark skin getting off. Black skin. The people with dark skin getting off. Black skin.
The conditions are getting critical.
Shalom, brothers and sisters. I am your host, Yehuda Moshe. And I would like to welcome you to a testimony in Jacob. Before we begin, I would like to give all praise and glory to Yahweh and his son, Yahshua, the anointed Savior, for the knowledge of righteousness, love, and the truth. In this series, we are taking a look at the tribe of Judah scattered and dispersed throughout Africa with emphasis on the Western regions. Please stay tuned. Okay, so the color of the Jews, okay, we'll start here. The color of the Jews, according to Eusebius. Now, before we get into the actual slide, for those of you who may not be aware who Eusebius was, he lived in the 4th century and figures prominently in the history of the early church as Bishop of Caesarea. Okay, so we extract a passage from his work, Chronicon, as to what he states as the physical appearance of the Jews in ancient times as well as his time. And thus he writes, and excuse me, the source above is New Researches on Ancient History, Volume 2 by Volney, published 1819. So Eusebius writes, here a singular analogy presents itself. Eusebius, in his Chronicon, translation by Scaliger, says in a year corresponding to 1575 BC that Ethiopians coming from the Indus River encamped and settled near Egypt. Okay, so that word Ethiopians, brothers and sisters, that may not know this already, means burnt face. Okay. The Jews, by their own avowal or admission, being of a Chaldean race, meaning a branch of black Arabs. It follows that they, the Jews, are real Ethiopians. Okay, so we see here by early church father Eusebius's own account that not only in 1575 BC, but also in his day, which is around the 4th century, the Jews were still known and recognized as a black-faced people. Now, we take a look at Genesis 11 and 31, the biblical account. Okay, and Terah took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, his son's son, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife. And they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan. And they came unto Haran and dwelt there. Okay, so we see, according to Genesis, that the Hebrew patriarchs, our fathers, came from the region of the land of the Chaldees, okay, which is Ur, one of the cities. And that in Eusebius's time and prior to his time, we see here that they are being described as a branch of black Ethiopians. Okay, so despite what pictures may come up on what a Chaldean is, you know, there's many books published, Google searches, we have a more direct account from a credible and notable church scholar and father. Okay, very important. All right, so this is where history meets prophecy. Okay, the source we're reading from is the History Civil and Commercial of the British West Indies, published in 1819 by Brian Edwards. Friday, December 16th, three Guinea ships belonging in the harbor full of slaves from Africa, I testified a wish to visit the ships previous to the sale. I would have visited them privately and unexpectedly, but it was not practical. Everything was prepared for our visit, as the least observing eye might have discovered. In particular, I was disgusted with a general jumping or dancing of Negroes on the deck, which some, and perhaps many of them, did voluntarily, but some under force or control, okay? Very important. Now, it's very common for the slaves to come on board, you know, for the need of, you know, exercise and making sure that their blood is flowing and they're staying healthy throughout the journey, which can take anywhere between 3 weeks to two and a half, maybe even 3 months, depending on, you know, the weather conditions, the navigators, if they're, you know, privy to the routes and that sort of thing. So it goes on to say, for I saw a sailor more than once catch those rudely by the arm who had ceased dancing and by gesture menace them to repeat their motion, clapping their hands and shout their song of Yah, Yah. So we see here that the slaves are chanting and shouting in praises of Yahweh, okay? So, Psalms 137 and starting at 1, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yeah, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, which is entertainment, okay? In all forms, by the way, that could be sexual entertainment, that could be, sport, you know, wrestling, that sort of thing. So, and some would be actually song and dance. Same, sing us one of the songs of Zion. Now, how shall we sing Yahweh's song in a strange land? Okay, so very prophetic in nature. Where history meets prophecy too. I'm going to go ahead and mute my mic, but this is from the film Amistad, produced by Steven Spielberg, 1997. And this is basically what happened on board the ship. Now, Steven Spielberg places this in the film, in my opinion, deliberately, you know, so that, you know, we are able to understand who we actually are as far as the children of Israel. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and mute my mic and you guys go ahead and have a close listen to the children of Israel singing the name of Yahweh on board ships. Take a listen. All right, so very powerful scene indeed by Steven Spielberg. Now, I want to pause on this screenshots just so we can kind of analyze a little bit what's going on in this particular scene. First off, notice the head coverings, okay? These are Shemitic characters or markers among many of the Shemitic tribes, okay? Now, they would want to say, you know, we were brought over were naked. We had no spinning. We didn't know how to weave. We didn't sew. That's me. But I will prove the contrary as you stick along with your brother. Getting back to the scene here. Notice the head coverings, okay? The women particularly. The only person that doesn't have a head covering is the actual slave who's leading the rebellion, okay? But everybody else has on fine garments of diverse colors, okay? And turbans, all sorts of cloths, and so forth, okay? So I think he fully understands that we are the children of God and the children of Israel, as he's showing here. So moving forward, getting back to our presentation, maps of Judah. Now this map here was created in 1743, the cartographers, Holman Ayres. Now, most of these maps here that I'm gonna show on the presentation, I got from geographicus.com, but many of these maps you can find all over the internet. All you have to do is just search in words like Judah, tribe of Judah in Africa, African Jews, African Jewish maps, stuff like that. You know, you can get different results. Okay, so here we are in the interior of Guinea. We can see clearly Judah situated in the west coast, okay? West coast of Africa. West African villages inhabited by the tribe of Judah. Okay, so we're going to get into this particular topic, but before we go into this particular slide, I want to show that there's been a great disparity, brothers and sisters, among historians, topographers, and even locals that live in the western regions of Africa today, with regards to the original name of this region. What I'm going to attempt to show is that despite its nominal identity, history does suggest that this region has indeed housed the exile of the house of Israel and the house of Judah, okay? So this particular account here was from a man, a slaver. He was actually agent general of the Royal Company of Africa and the Islands of America at Paris. He was, his name was John Barbot, born in 1655. He died in 1713. Now he's notated as having two manuscripts from his slave voyages that he endeavored in 1678 and another in 1682. One of which, the latter, the one in 1682, that one is either out of print or is just lost to history as far as his manuscript and his writings. Now, in his manuscript from 1678, it was actually published after his death. He couldn't find a publisher while he was alive, but his brother went on to publish it in 1732. And the name of that manuscript is entitled Description of the Coast of North and South Guinea. And it's basically, by and large, it's his work, but he also takes from other navigators and other explorers, such as I think Dutchman Dapper is mentioned as one of the explorers that he's given this particular account. So that's just a short abridged version of who this of the actual writing. We're going to get into what he actually has to say in his work concerning the tribe of Judah in the west coast of Africa. So here's the work here, and we're taking it from page 475, and it reads, "The custom of sitting in the open air at public ceremonies or to deliberate on affairs of slate or to hear causes may be derived from the Jews." Okay, so off the bat, he's comparing us to the Jews, okay, in West Africa. As we read in 2 Chronicles 38:9, that the kings Jehoshaphat and Ahab sat on their thrones in the place of Samaria near the gate. In ancient times, the towns were not so large as our capital cities in Europe, which can hardly be subsisted by the product of the lands for 100 miles about them. They were then small, inhabited but by a small number of laborers and husbandmen sufficient to till the ground about them. Thence it is that the sole tribe of Judah reckoned 115 such towns within its precinct. So, brothers and sisters, he's referencing these inhabitants in West Africa as the tribe of Judah with 115 different towns and precincts. And some might say, well, there's no account of Israelites in West Africa, not in the 17th century or prior. And brothers and sisters, not only is that not the case, okay, we have from a very prominent source, West African historian, that Judah or the tribe of Judah is situated in West Africa. Okay, so that is very key in our understanding of our West African roots and our history there. Okay, so fast forwarding about 200 years later, we see the same account, only this time by Richard Burton. And this the source is from Mission to Galilee, King of Dahomey, 1864. Our interest is right around here, the middle. So the land around is called Lefefon from the Nago people, whose chief, Chade, was slain by King Gezo, and who were finally settled here. The eye dwells with delight upon the numerous country villages, like the 115 towns of the tribe of Judah. Again, 200 years after it was initially stated by this man right here, Jean Barbot, in 1678, we see 200 years after the same 115 precincts or towns and villages of the tribe of Judah, not the territory. These are the ethnic descendants of Judah, and the case is closed. Okay, here it is right here, brothers and sisters. Praise Yahweh. Praise Yahweh. He is God. Israelite immigration into West Africa. Our source is the topography and history, political, social, and natural of French Africa. And this is by John Morel, 1854. Now, the passage that we're reading, it's actually from an earlier work. He had the title Baron. His name is Jean Jacques Baudet, I can't pronounce that, of Algeria, Volume 3. Okay. History has recorded the date and cause of the Israelitish immigration into West Africa. Okay. So this is no longer up for refutation or debate. There is an Israelitish immigration that occurred in West Africa after the destruction of Jerusalem. Now, I would venture to say prior to the destruction of Jerusalem, there has always been maritime trade and exchanges and communication between Israel and Africa, because I don't make the distinction. I actually believe that they are one and the same. They sit on the same tectonic stone, okay, if you will. So it goes on to say, but the immemorial establishment of the Sinite Jews, who in the whole extent of Barbary, and that's North Africa, are mixed with the Berber population. And we'll get into a little bit more what that word, what it means to be a Berber, okay? It is not a, it does not signify race, okay? It actually comes from Barber, which is a region in North Africa. Okay, so I'll read that again. Who in the whole extent of Barbary are mixed up with the Berber population would lead us to suppose that it forms the foundation of this immigration from, here it is, from the East and Syria, which Sallust has related in these words. Okay, so we will stop there. So we, our main point of focus that we want to take note of is that the Israelites' immigration is from the east. Anything east of Africa, well, you're in the Levant. Okay, places like Iraq, Iran, okay, Israel, Jordan, all these different areas, right? So, from the east and Syria. So we move to the next slide. Okay, was ancient Syria black or white? Because we know that the immigration came from Syria, right? And our sources from New Researches on Ancient History, Volume 2, by Volney, 1819. Several passages of Strabo contain on this subject positive facts and luminous ideas. The Armenians, says this learned geographer in Book 1, page 41, the Arabs and the Syrians have a remarkable conformity in the form of their bodies, in their manner of living, and in their language. And the Assyrians are in every aspect like the Arabs and Syrians, page 42. Now, the name of the Syrians, book 27, page 737, seems to extend from Babylonia to the Gulf of Issus, and even formerly as far as Euxine, okay? For the Cappadocians, both of Pontus and of Taurus, are still called white Syrians. No doubt, because they are black Syrians, okay? Very important. So we see the distinction between what is called a white Syrian and a black Syrian, because a Syrian does not denote a particular ethnic group, okay? We can have just about any human being from any walk of life move to the land of Syria, and they would be considered Syrians just the same, okay? So that is what we want to see here, that according to Strabo, there has been a difference between white Syrians and black Syrians, and that these Syrians that immigrated into the west coast of Africa, what we just read, came from those regions, those parts, okay? The east and Syria. Very important. So Israelite immigration into West Africa, part two. Our source is from the modern part of a universal history from the earliest time, volume 14, 1759, excuse me. And below are our contributors, and you can read individually what they had to, what they've given an account to this this publication, this work. Among those vast herds of them which are dispersed throughout this great continent, meaning the Jews dispersed throughout Africa, these have been since dislodged from their high and almost inaccessible mountains for their frequent ill offices to those princes, and siding with their revolted subjects, and have been brought into due subjection and laid under tribute to them. Okay, so that's a brief peek at the political and even economic situation that we were subjected to by the princes, and being laid under tribute to those various tribes and princes throughout the western regions. Okay. Since which time they have lived dispersed into several provinces of that empire. Remember that the tribe of Judah from the previous slides would make up 115 provinces, okay, within that region, okay? So it says they have been dispersed into several provinces of that empire and have made but an inconsiderable figure in it, meaning we would not rise to any type of economic prowess, okay? So now, there are some who call themselves ordinary Jews of the posterity or the children of Abraham, who pretend to have formerly come in colonies. So they want to discredit and say that we don't have oral tradition, but, you know, we will prove otherwise. And to have settled themselves in Egypt, Abyssinia, and along the Niger. And these last are more numerous and considerable than the two former. So these last, meaning the Jews that settled along the Niger, are more than the former. So more Jews are settled over here than in Egypt and Abyssinia, which is very important. This is the history of the immigration of the Jews into West Africa. But those who came and are here still in the greatest number are such as refuge themselves in these parts, either after the destruction of Jerusalem and the dispersion of the Jewish nation by Titus Vespasian, mentioned in a former chapter, who fled from other persecutions. Now I know. Okay, so more Israelite immigration into West Africa, part three. And our source is from a select library of Nicene and post-Nicene Fathers of the Christian Church, volume one. It was actually published 1890, but it's a collection of, as the title suggests, different works of the post-Christian fathers, okay? I have up on the screen here, Luke chapter 21 and verse 20, and we'll go ahead and read, but we'll take it actually from Luke chapter 21 and verse 17. I want to start there. And it reads on this wise, "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but there shall not a hair on your head perish. In your patience possess ye your souls. And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee into the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. But woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days. For there shall be great distress in the land, and wrath upon this people. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled." Hallelujah. So here we see the prophecy of the utter destruction of Jerusalem under the commander Titus and Adrian, okay, in the last siege. So we'll go ahead and read the text. And I won't read the entire text. I just want to point out Siege of the Jews under Adrian, and that's also Hadrian, same person. The war raged most fiercely in the 18th year of Adrian at the city of Bethara, which was a very secure fortress situated not far from Jerusalem. When the siege had lasted a long time and the rebels had been driven to the last extremity by hunger and thirst, and the instigator of the rebellion had suffered his just punishment, the whole nation was prohibited from this time on by a decree and by the commands of Adrian from ever going up to the country about Jerusalem. For the emperor gave orders that they should not even see from a distance the land of their fathers. Such is the account of Aristo of Pella. And thus, when the city had been emptied of the Jewish nation and had suffered the total destruction of its ancient inhabitants, it was colonized by a different race. And the Roman city, which subsequently arose, changed its name and was called Aelia, in honor of Emperor Aelius Adrian. Okay, brothers and sisters, so we see that the city had been emptied of its original inhabitants and colonized by a different race altogether, okay? As you can see, the Gentiles boasting that this was the just punishment of the insurrection, okay? And just for them defending their homeland. So we can see the mentality of some of these so-called church fathers, okay? All right. A brief history of today's Jews of North Africa. And our first source we're going to look at is The Jews of Africa by Sidney Middleton, and published in 1920. Dahiya She's actually a Jewess. She's a lineal descendant of the high priest Aaron, as you can see from the footnote. Dahiya died in the year 703, and from this period, the Arabs dominated Morocco, and the religion of the Prophet, meaning Muhammad, became the paramount creed of the country. Okay, so we see the spread of Islam starting to make its way in North Africa, Algeria area, Morocco, Tunis, etc. No doubt, many of the Berber races who had adopted the Jewish faith, I want to say that again, adopted, that is to say, converted to the Jewish faith, now embraced the tenets of Islam, although they retained certain Jewish customs and observances which their descendants practice up to this day. Other tribes which preserve their Jewish beliefs have, however, been greatly affected by their Muhammadan environment, and in language and external appearances are entirely Berber. So you kind of see they're trying to relate Berber with a ethnicity, and you can't do that. Okay, so our second source, and this is going into more of the conversion of the Jews of North Africa and Algeria. So our source is the topography and history, political, social, and natural of French Africa. And we used that source earlier by John Morrell. And it states, if we may believe the Arab historians, most of the African Berbers and Arabs professed the Hebrew faith in the 7th and 8th centuries, meaning they themselves converted to the Hebrew faith, okay, to Judaism, in the 7th and 8th century, that is 600 and 700 AD. And the preaching of Muhammadism or Islam made no way amongst them. This would appear to explain the phenomenon of the Jews forming till lately, 1843, a fourth of the population of Algiers, which is Algeria, and more than four-fifths of that of Iran. Okay, and these are just some of the Jews of Algeria today, places like Morocco, Tunis, Fez, okay, Algeria. The source is actually from judaicalgeria.com. And these pictures, though they're a little vintage from the early 20th century, these people still remain, okay, and to this very day, and they look the same. Okay, and these are the Jews of Algeria. Now, according to the first slide, brothers and sisters, do these actually look like the people that was described by Eusebius? I mean, let's say they were the House of Israel. Well, what's stopping us from saying that we're the House of Israel as well? When we have the record, when we have the actual truth, okay? So I want to challenge you. Research these documents. Check out the sources. Read them for yourselves, okay? Now, with that said, we'll go ahead and end things here. Okay, so there it is. I want to thank you all for tuning in to part one of this presentation. If you found this presentation educational, please hit the like button, leave a comment down below, subscribe to the channel, and also hit the notification bell for more updates. In part two of this series, we will further explore the Jews of West Africa. But until then, brothers and sisters, please be safe and shalom.
The people with dark skin getting off. Black skin. The people with dark skin getting off.
The conditions are getting critical.